DoorDash, just one of the big, big public market debuts that's set to happen this week. It is set to price after the close today and begin trading tomorrow. We're looking at a price range of $90 to $95 a share. That's what's in the latest S1, so it could raise a little over $3 billion. Let's bring in someone to talk more about whether you should be buying this stock. Tom White is D.A. Davidson Research Analyst. He already has a buy rating on DoorDash ahead of that debut. Tom, I think the main question for me is, how and when is DoorDash going to make money?
Yeah, well, first off, thanks for having me. Good morning. On an adjusted EBITDA basis, which, you know, obviously is not net income, but is something as a metric that institutional investors focus on as an indicator of a company's ability to become kind of cash flow positive, DoorDash actually has been EBITDA profitable the last two quarters and had positive net income in the second quarter. Now, obviously, the pandemic has been a real big tailwind for all these online food delivery platforms. It's catalyzed new customer acquisition at a very, very sort of efficient way. You know, you just had new customers basically seeking out these platforms. So they were all able to take down their marketing and advertising spend basically down to zero and still grow revenues very healthily. We do think, though, that on the other side of the pandemic, a lot of the share gains that DoorDash had established, these guys have really grown their market share over the last couple of years. They're now the category leader with 50% share, and they were steadily gaining share before the pandemic. And we expect that kind of dynamic to continue after the pandemic. So we think over the next, call it 3 to 4 years, these guys will be solidly EBITDA profitable and on their way to probably 20% adjusted EBITDA margins and also net income profitability with time as well.
Tom, if I read your modeling right, you're looking for earnings next year on DoorDash, earnings per share, GAAP earnings, 24 cents. But if the U.S., let's say half of the U.S. population is vaccinated, they're back out there eating at restaurants and forests, whatever restaurants are left after the pandemic, how much risk does that present to your modeling?
Yeah, so, you know, just as the pandemic has been a tailwind to these businesses this year, we expect that the rollout of an effective and widely deployed vaccine is going to be a headwind next year, particularly in the second half of the year. We've tried to be adequately conservative in thinking about how revenue growth will slow, particularly in the third and fourth quarters of next year. And we hope we've done an adequate job there of applying conservatism to the model. You know, these guys grew their revenue 268% in the third quarter of 2020. We've got them growing just north of 20% revenue growth in the fourth quarter of next year. So, you know, again, we expect this industry to come down to earth a little bit in terms of the growth rates that we've seen over the last few quarters. But we do think DoorDash will be able to maintain its leadership position and keep taking share the same way it was before the pandemic. And that the pandemic has just sort of supercharged that dynamic in the last few months.
You know, Tom, an area that you guys call out as a strength for DoorDash has been in the suburban markets outside of the major, you know, tier one cities where you're going to have multiple players in there. Is that something that you think, you know, kind of piggybacking off of Brian's question, is that something that you think can continue for DoorDash even when things get normalized in the world? You know, the suburban market is, you know, pretty much been underserved by online delivery for the last 15 years.
Yeah, so look, you know, I think that revenue growth is going to slow everywhere, and that includes in the suburban markets. Over the course of this pandemic, the suburban markets have been the fastest growing. They've been fast in sort of overall industry sales for online food delivery. They've been growing faster than the tier one cities, right? The tier one cities were really the first to get online food delivery. I don't want to say that those markets are mature by any stretch of the imagination. I think those large cities still have a lot of growth potential as well. But these suburban markets, you know, they've been able to enjoy online food delivery sort of late. and so we think that the growth prospects for those markets will continue to be strong. But obviously, you know, things will slow down. But we think that those markets are going to grow faster than the tier one cities, even on the other side of the pandemic. DoorDash, as you mentioned, you know, they focused very early on those suburban markets, smaller cities, when it was not particularly in vogue to do so for companies in this space. So they were able to enjoy this period of not a lot of competitive intensity, were able to sort of build their brand, create a bit of loyalty with consumers in those markets. So we think DoorDash is going to remain well positioned in the suburban markets on the other side of this.
And Tom, when you look, whether it's in those areas or in urban areas, in terms of market share with the proliferation of these services out there, how is it going to have a leg up? Is it that early mover advantage in certain geographic areas you're talking about? Is it something about their pricing model that's more attractive to restaurants? What's going to give them that edge?
Yeah, so a couple of things. I think early mover advantage is certainly important. Again, being able to establish your brand, create relationships with consumers in those markets. DoorDash has also had a bit more success at promoting its membership, subscription membership program for consumers than maybe some of the other food delivery platforms. So, you know, DoorDash has got over 5 million members of Dash Pass, which is, you pay $9.99 a month and you basically get unlimited per order delivery or free per order delivery fees at a bunch of restaurants. The other platforms like Uber Eats and Grubhub have, you know, at most sort of a million. That's, I think, an area where DoorDash has maybe out-executed its peers. Another area, and this is sort of a little nuance sort of in the weeds, but DoorDash was also aggressive early on at adding what we call non-partner restaurants. So restaurants where the restaurant itself didn't even know that it had a formal relationship with the food delivery platform, but a DoorDash would feature that restaurant on its site. Therefore, DoorDash was able to show consumers, you know, a broader breadth and more variety of restaurants. And that was something that would keep consumers coming back. DoorDash has subsequently been able to go and convert a lot of those non-partner restaurants to full partner status. But those are a few things that I think account for, the share gains that we've seen.
All right, Tom White, thank you so much. Appreciate it. DA Davidson Research Analyst. Appreciate it, Tom.